I went to, he said, he's telling me about this machine that was really bad for me, moving my spirit. And I went over and said, you know, I'm moving, and I was just being blessed. And I said, okay, that's me, I'm moving. And I went. And that first time I met my, as he turned away from me, on my heart, the Lord put the words orphanages. And since I was 7, I always wanted to be a missionary. So I got to know him. And then around December, the Lord said to me, Marlene, would you stay with my servant, Marlene, no matter what, I'm all home? And I said, well, yes, all I want. Because I pictured I'm going to be up there in the mission field, and the team was having a great time. I didn't picture anything but a really good time. And he asked me 3 times, and each time he asked me differently, and each time I said, yes, Lord. And then I got to know one, and then I really got to know one. And then I got to see a broken vessel. I got to see the flesh. I got to see the anointing. I got to see and know one. And then when he really started getting more sick, I don't know, he was staying at this motel on Costa Mesa. And I would go home during the day, and I got returned to someone's floor, I remember that. And the last week we were there, you know, I believed vivid, you know, this is it, we're going to do fine, you know, we just have to depend on God, lean in, you know, it's okay, he's going to do it all. And Ronnie was sitting, in fact, he had pneumonia. And then what happened was that we had our last $200, God's $200, in the physical. And the bill was $197. I thought, okay, we have $3 for food, and we have to buy medicine. So how are we going to do this now, God? And the next day, we got a call from John Brown's museum, the church. And Ronnie was really getting more sick, and they set us up in the home in Belmont. And it was just wonderful, and I really thank the Lord. And I saw Lonnie go downhill every day. We would go to San Diego, we would drive, and we would pray all day, and we would have tapes on the car. The Holy Spirit would just get filling the car, praising Jesus, and we'd be facing all of this terrible stuff at the hospital. But yet we were there, and we were on a mission. You know, we didn't care what they were going to say, because God was in charge. We knew that. When God called me to stay with Lonnie, he called me to my first assignment. I didn't even know that we got to be on assignment. I didn't know about the kingdom of God. I just knew what I was taught by the nuns for 12 years. So I got to be on assignment, and the assignment got to be pretty, pretty difficult. And what I learned is that when God calls you on an assignment, he will give you the grace to get through it. Only he. There's less of me, more of you, Lord. And I got to share with you a couple of things that I wasn't going to, but I really feel okay. I've been praying on this. And it's about being a servant. It's about how Jesus wants us to be. It's about when Ronnie was so sick and I had to do some bodily functions. And I couldn't do it. I said, God, I can't do this. Lord, I can't take these tests. Lord, please help me. And I was kneeling in the bathroom floor, crying out to the Lord, saying, I could do this for my children, but I certainly couldn't do this for someone I really didn't know, who was getting kind of, I didn't even know if I liked them, that was. And I knelt down on the floor, and God said, I will do it. You know, you just do the motions, and I will do it. And I prayed, and from that day to Lonnie's last breath, I knew it was me. I knew that the Holy Spirit, that once we just surrender ourselves, really surrender ourselves, that he really does it. And the last couple of days, the last week of Lonnie's life, he looked at me a couple of times, and he said to me, one of them was, Marlene, I want you to surround my body with candles. Something Italian. And then he said, I want for the glory of God. And he made me promise a long time ago that he would not die alone. And he didn't want to suffer. He was asking God, God, I just don't want to suffer. So that morning, I woke up Friday morning, and Jeanette and his mom was there. The two of us were there. And I went into the living room to pray. And I felt the Holy Spirit say, today is a good day for me to die. And I went back that was there, you know, holding her son and ministering to him. And we went in there together. And his breathing was labored. And he just laid there, and he was breathing, and his mom and I said, we cleaned him up, we bathed him, his mom put baby powder on him. It was so awesome. And then his mind rest. And it was like, he's in your presence, Lord. And it was like, we saw that. We saw the spirit go to the glory of God. And what was left was his shell, his tent. And it really took the sting out of death. And I looked at it, and his mother and I wept and we cried. And then the Holy Spirit went into action. And the Holy Spirit just had me go out into the bathroom. His mother went outside for a minute. And I had curfew. I had this little tiny bottle of curfew that was expensive. And I got the curfew. And I went in there with the curfew. And I put it on his head and his hands, and I was weeping. And I was crying. And I wanted to say, they did this for me. She did this for me. And when you do this with the lips of my brethren, and it like it all came together for me, that I had been serving the Lord by staying at my post, by staying at my assignment. And it wasn't easy in the physical because I was really wandering. And the Lord just has completely changed me to life. And I got to thank one. But most importantly, I got to see how precious it was to Jesus, and how we're all so precious to Jesus, and how he was heard, and people came in and listened to him. And all I have to say is that he's with the Lord now, and I got to see him leave. And some pastor said to me, if Lonnie Frisbee was your first assignment, I could hardly wait to see the last one. So praise the Lord. I love you. I thank you for letting me serve you. We get to serve Jesus. And I just want to say, my son is 97% healed now. He had 7 surgeries, 3 hospitals, a year in a coma deep and in the other part. And he's serving the Lord. He's up there in LA preaching the good news, you know. Visually in here, can't drive, can't read. But he doesn't need any of those things because
my name is Dave, and I'm originally from Johannesburg, South Africa. I was contacted in January of 1980 by an American missionary who was living in South Africa at the time. And he asked if I would have this young man come and minister in our church. And something inside of me said that it was the right thing to do, even though I had no idea what I was letting myself in for at the time. Lonnie came and on a Sunday evening, and our service began at 6:30 that evening. And I think that the people that were there that night would recall that as probably the most extraordinary church experience of their lives. Our meeting began at 6:30, and it was 11:45 that night. Not a single person had left. We had seen people come to faith in Christ. We saw people filled with the Holy Spirit. We saw people physically healed. But above all, for the first time, for many of them, saw a visible demonstration of the presence and the power of God in the most authentic fashion imaginable. Some years later, a large team came to South Africa to conduct a series of church growth conferences. And in the evening, we had celebration meetings that attracted people from a wide representation of the church in the country. And I'll never forget that night for one particular reason. At one juncture in the meeting, Lonnie invited the small children out to the front to be prayed for. And little kids came up, some of them possibly no more than 3 or 4 years of age. And in the most gentle fashion imaginable, Lonnie asked that the Holy Spirit would come on these children. I don't know that I would have adequate language to describe to you what an incredible moment that was.
I think that for everybody that was there, it's been etched on their mind as one of the most significant experiences of their lives, because you can perhaps fool adults some of the time, but kids are either going to get the real thing or nothing at all. Some of these kids lay on the floor for an hour and a half, looking almost like they were in a semi-comatose kind of state, with this sheen of glory covering their faces. And I'll never forget Lonnie turning around and looking to the person who was coordinating the meeting at that time. His eyes were, you know, full of tears, and just his face encapsulated the sense of glory that was resting on these kids. That night, many of the parents had to carry their children home in the same condition as they were on the floor at that time. What it has reminded me of is of the authenticity of the work that God did through Lonnie. When Lonnie is in South Africa, my phone usually rings for churches of every kind in the scripture desire to have Lonnie speak and minister in their churches, recognizing him as somewhat strange, in fact somewhat bizarre at times, but brought the dimension of the Holy Spirit into the life of the church that for me was unprecedented. And I am truly thankful to God for the opportunity that I had to minister with Lonnie, to have him stay in my home, for the change that he brought to so many people in the church in South Africa. Churches that were changed, I think, possibly for good as a result of the encounter with the power of God. And I'm very grateful for the opportunity to share him. Thank you very much.
There is a special place, the most beautiful place I've ever seen. There's a throne surrounded by angels singing hallelujahs to the King of Kings. I invite to the throne room, and the King himself has been.